Volevo chiedervi se voi usa, qualcuno di voi usa matematica?
Poco.
Io uso due cose in croce di matematica.
Ok. Comunque, diciamo per quelli che volevo sapere, per quelli che, del vostro anno, volevo fare una. Dunque, innanzitutto, avete un rappresentante degli studenti, immagino, sì, dalla magistrale, che sarà diverso forse rispetto a quello della triennale, o è lo stesso sempre?
Sì, dovremmo averlo, ma non sono sicuro di chi sia esattamente.
Ok,
Non sono sicuro, posso dire.
vabbè, sei riuscito a farmi sapere chi è, perché volevo fare una piccola minima indagine sull'utilità che può avere per voi il matematico, cioè per quelli della magistrale. Perché se voi dite che non lo usate, vabbè, non lo usate. Se però invece dite che lo usate, che può essere utile, a quel punto diciamo sarebbe bene farlo sapere anche all'ENISA, perché in modo, visto che la licenza va rinnovata ogni anno, e quindi per decidere se rinnovarla sarebbe bene sapere se gli studenti lo stanno usando, se lo trovano utile oppure no.
Beh,
Quindi,
lo usiamo nel corso di metodi matematici della magistrale, comprendo il problema.
quello immagino perché diciamo lo fa Drago, quindi sicuramente so che lo usa. Però diciamo che servirebbero forse delle, come dire, cioè se voi lo state usando anche per la tesi, ad esempio, sarebbe comodo saperlo. Se qualcuno di voi lo usa anche per le tesi di magistrale, perché in questo modo si può dire al Dipartimento che è uno strumento che serve agli studenti, se serve, magari non serve, quindi non lo so. Comunque, fatemi sapere chi è il vostro rappresentante, così magari parlo con lui e vediamo, e vedo cosa mi dice. Lui potrebbe fare una piccola indagine tra di voi, capire quanta gente lo usa e poi insomma vedere come procedere. Vabbè, adesso andiamo avanti con le nostre cose. So, I think we started to do the Landau-Ginzburg, which is a phenomenological theory of phase transition, second order phase transition. In which there is a field that is introduced, and we will consider the case of a scalar field P of X, and we are in D dimensions, just to be more general. And this field could be, basically it's called the order parameter. And basically, it tells you in which phase you are. So, if you are in the in a certain phase, which is the most, let's say, symmetric to some extent, phi is equal to zero. Whereas, if you are in, and so typically this happens at large temperature. And whereas, if you are in the in a phase which is in which there is some symmetry breaking. If you think about the ferromagnetism, the value of phi is different from zero. So in the case of ferromagnetism, this quantity, this field, the order parameter is basically the magnetization per particle, or the total magnetization, which is indeed zero for temperatures larger than TC, whereas it's different from zero at smaller temperature. And we saw that the mechanism generating non-vanishing value of the magnetization is a sort of spontaneous symmetry breaking, in the sense that if you look at the Helmholtz free energy, mean field, you see that when you are above TC, the order param the minimum of the free energy is obtained by the zero value of the order parameter. Whereas when you are below TC, there is the formation, the appearance of two minima, which are degenerate in the case that we were analyzing. And actually, the free energy is minimized by a finite value of the magnetization. Okay? So this is the paradigm for spontaneous symmetry breaking that is used also in particle physics, for instance, in the case of the Higgs phenomenon. Okay? Now, the Landau Ginzburg is a phenomenological approach that generalizes this picture to this quantity, which is called order parameter, that could be a magnetization in the case of ferromagnets. It could be the density difference between a liquid and gas in a liquid gas phase transition, or it could be any other quantity that allow to establish whether you are in a phase or in another one. For instance, superfluids or in superconductivity, there is another order parameter which is based on the pairing of two electrons, for instance, in the case of superconductivity, or in the case of superfluidity, is related to the amount of particles that are in the ground state, okay? So it's similar to the Bose-Einstein problems. Okay, so this is just a short reminder. What is this order parameter? Then the theory starts with a functional of P, is an energy function, which is by definition the integral in the dimension of a certain quantity, which contains a term that is similar to sort of kinetic term. That is written in this term. Is the gradient of phi squared modulo squared times a certain parameter. Then there is a potential, and there is an external and a coupling with an external field that could be, for instance, a magnetic field that could be anything. Now this is somehow is telling you that you have to pay a price for having non-homogeneous or non-uniform phi. So this is an energy function that will appear now in a moment in a partition function. So the larger the gradient. So if you have, jumps or final gradients of phi, then you have to pay a price, which means that in a situation in which there is no potential, the most convenient configuration is the one in which phi is uniform, okay? And the other terms, this is a coupling with an external phi, whereas W of phi in x is a potential, and by basically somehow borrowing the picture that we had in the Ising model, this potential is written in terms of certain couplings, g2 phi squared plus g3 phi cubed plus g4 phi to the power 4, etc. Okay. In the quantum field theory, for those of you who have done it, this will be a self-interaction, a cubic self-interaction, and this is a quartic self-interaction. I will not add here a linear term in P because somehow it's included already. Okay, so up to this level is just a sort of phenomenological construction that at some point we'll try to reproduce the same feature that we had in the case of the Ising model in midfield. Okay, what we will do, I tell you from the beginning within this theory, is just to introduce another thing that is called correlation function, and we will see that at the critical point, the correlation function has some interesting features, in particular the correlation, what is called the correlation length as a divergence. Okay, so this is what we will do when we finish this part. Okay. Now, what you do with this energy density functional is to assume or postulate solve canonical partition function. By using the same structure that we had in the case of the canonical partition function that we have done up to now, the only difference here that instead of having, for instance, if you compare with the Ising model, we have a lattice, and therefore we have a sum over the spin configurations, or if you have the particles, the canonical partition function is built by using a set of eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian, no? So just to remind you, this was something like this, right? Well, actually, if you want to be, this is the trace e to the beta h, okay? This was the canonical partition function. And then if you use a set of state eigenstates of the Hamiltonian, that it is written in terms of a sum, no? Something like this. Now the same structure is used also in this case. Now the only difference, which is not a marginal difference, is that instead of having a trace or an integral, here we have what is called a functional integral, that I will say in a moment what it is. And here we have e to the minus beta and the functional that we introduced before, that was this e. Okay, so this by definition is a canonical partition function. That it is itself a functional of h, which in principle could depend also on x, and we are integrating over phi. Now these are an integral. That I'm not sure how familiar you are with this. But we will not actually compute it, but just to say what it is actually, it would be the fault from a, let's say, empirical point of view, this path integral, for instance, let's take one dimension. When I do this integral over d phi of something, this must be interpreted in the following way. Suppose that we are in one dimension, so the field depends only on the variable x, and here we make a plot of phi of x. So what you do is to discretize space and take all the possible configuration. So suppose that this is x1, x2, x3, x4, and suppose that this point is P1, P2, P3, P4, where P1 is by definition P of X1, P2 is by definition P of X2, etc. Now, when you do that, is basically this integral represents, magari lo scrivo, qua, must be considered as the limit for infinitely thin grid, so for if you want xn going to infinity, of the integral now on dp1, dp2, dp3, etc. Okay, so basically what you do is to probe all the possible, is a functional integral. So you probe all the possible configuration of the fields. So you can imagine it as taking a grid in space with certain values of the field and this grid, and then you integrate overall in single DP1, DP2, DP3, which are at this point normal integrals. Okay, and then you send this to infinity because this must be continuous. Okay, we will not calculate this, okay? But just to say how one can define it in general. And actually, there are only a few cases in which one can compute it exactly. Questo l'avete visto da qualche parte. Maybe you saw it in quantum field theory, some of you, or maybe, probably, don't know, I'm not sure.
Sì, in campi 1 l'abbiamo visto.
Ah, l'avete visto già, ok, va bene. Però campi 1 non è obbligatorio per tutti, quindi magari qualcuno non l'ha fatto. Ok. Okay, so this is the functional integral. Mm-hmm. Now, well, what we will need at some point, this is for us just a formal way to write the thing. But I mean, from the intuitive point of view, what is this mathematical entity? Is the generalization, if you want, of the case of the Ising model. So for the Ising model, at some point, we have to do a sum over all the possible configuration of spins, so S1, S2, and Sn. Okay, where they are sit in a lattice, so they are a fixed configuration. And we were integrating over all the possible configuration of this. Okay, now this was a sort of filling, if you want, with two possible values and defined on a grid. Now this is more complicated because you don't have a grid anymore, you don't have a lattice, but this is a continuous, it's a field, it depends on the space, so it's a continuous field. And the possible values that he can have, they are not just -1 and +1, but they vary in a certain range of real numbers, okay? But somehow it is the generalization of this sum of all the possible configuration of spin. I don't know if this clarifies a little bit more what it is. Okay, so now, once you introduce the canonical partition function, with this exotic mathematical tool, then you go on and you do the thermodynamics, and in particular we know that the Helmholtz free energy is -kBT log of the canonical partition function, so this is the Helmholtz free energy, and if you have a certain quantity O and you want to compute an ensemble average, so the way you do it is the usual one, in the sense that you put this O in the functional integral of e to the beta x divided by the same quantity. So you just copy really the same structure that you had in the case of, let's say, statistical mechanics of particles. So if you want this, it's called statistical mechanics of field, because this is a field, okay? Well, actually, there are many similarities between this formalism and the one that you use in quantum field theory, because at some point, the only difference that you have with respect to this and quantum field theory is that instead of having minus beta, there you have I, okay? And then there is the Lagrangian there, okay? It's basically the difference. You have used the path integral or the functional integral to compute, for instance, green function and all these things. Okay, so this is the way you define ensemble averages. And for instance, suppose that case of H uniform. So we have a magnetic field, for instance, or an external field that does not depend on the position. It's a uniform. Now, if you do the minus derivative of A with respect to H, this keeps you put down an integral of the order parameter integrated over the x. And therefore, this would be the expectation value of phi, that is the expectation value actually of the integral in the dimension of p of x. And this is called total order parameter. So it's not the value of this field in a certain point, but it is the ensemble average of the integral of p with respect to x. And the way you get it is basically, it just remind you, just to show you, that in this function, at some point, you have h, x, p of x. But actually, if h is uniform, then you can pull it out of the integral, and you just have this integral at the numerator. So when you derive with respect to h, you get back, you get down an integral here, and therefore, the role of O is played by this integral, and therefore this will be the expectation value. Okay. Bene. Now the story goes on, trying to generalize or let's say to copy the same structure of the Ising model. And this will provide, say, a reasonable form for the functional. So, by using, if you want, the results of Ising model. One postulates that the form of this potential is provided by the following form. If we contain a certain constant positive times t, where t is the deviation from the critical temperature, and then we have a phi squared of x plus b phi four of x. Okay, this is just postulated by remembering what we got in the case of the one dimension of the two of the d dimension actually the Ising model in field. We had at some point close to the critical point. This is important. Close to the critical point, we had done an expansion and we saw that there was a quadratic term and a quartic term that at the end provides this phenomenon of spontaneous symmetry breaking. No? So the role played there by M, I think we call it M, now it's played by this field, which is phi, which in principle could depend also on x. Okay. Now the situation actually follows in a very similar way as we have done in the case of the Ising model. So in particular, once we have introduced the potential of the field, the partition function, of course, will be the one that we defined before. So dp e to the minus beta e of t, which is a functional. And now one can write phi of x in a similar way as we have done in the Ising model, as a mean field value. Which I call M plus fluctuations. Okay. And once I do the separation of the mean field, which does not, which does not depend on X, it's a uniform value plus fluctuation, I put the ansatz in here. And I get the following structure for the canonical partition function. So we have d or phi, then I have the exponential of minus beta, here I have the integral. Maybe I write it explicitly or maybe not. Okay, so let me write first explicitly once. The functional was provided by this formula, so it's epsilon squared divided by 2, and this is the gradient for phi square modulus plus a t phi of x squared plus b phi of x to the power of 4, and then there is minus phi of x, and then we have h. Suppose that h, in this case, I think it does not depend on u, so I take each uniform. To obtain the same results that we got in the Ising model, okay? Just for that. Now you introduce these ansatz here, okay? And you will see that the gradient, of course, does not get any contribution from m because it's uniform, so then the only thing so the gradient will act only on the fluctuations, whereas in this phi squared and phi to the power 4, we will have a m squared, m to the power 4, and then all the other terms which contains the fluctuation. Okay? But the important point is that m is now independent of x, and therefore the gradient does not do anything to m. Okay? Therefore, I can separate actually this function and integral into two terms, so one which is nested and we neglect it basically, and the other one which is the mean field result. Okay, so z of c, which was the phi into the minus the functional of x, there's a beta missing here. Now this is equal to aspetta, facciamo un passaggino. Okay, so this, the functional was an integral, but considering just the part which is the first part, which was m, which is uniform, when I do the integral, I get just a t m squared plus b m to the power of 4 minus hm times the volume plus, and here I have the difficult part, which is the integral of dx, then I have an epsilon squared, here I have the gradient of delta phi, and then all the other terms. Okay, so now this is a functional f of delta px. Okay, this functional depends on the fluctuations, whereas we have another part that has just m, which is the mean field value. Okay, so now I introduce this in here. This does not depend on phi anymore because this is basically now just delta px. And therefore I get that the canonical partition function can be actually factorized into a part that contains minus beta, the volume, and then this quantity here, a t m squared plus b m to the power of 4 minus hm, which comes from this part, and then I have a complicated structure that actually I will neglect. That is can be written in this fashion, d of delta px, and then I have e to the minus beta times the functional of delta px. Okay, now, so the mean field approximation basically the following. Mean field approximation in the mean field approximation, basically, I just neglect this part, okay? So I neglect this fluctuation. And that means that the canonical partition function is just e to the minus beta volume times this quantity. And by remembering which is the relation between the canonical partition function and the free energy, again, the free energy per volume, and most free energy per volume, is equal to basically this quantity here. So A T m squared plus d m to the power of 4 minus h m. Okay. Then the story continues in the same, exactly the same way we did for the Isaac model, so I will not repeat. So basically what you do here is to minimize A with respect to n at different values of t and in principle also h. Okay, you have the structure which is an algebraic structure now. Once you take t positive, so above the c, the minimum is in m equal to 0, if you neglect this term. So in the case of h equal to 0. And if t is smaller than 0, then you have a quartic with two minima. So it works exactly in the same way as the Ising model, and this is actually done just for that. So in order to mimic the behavior of the Ising model, which is actually more general in the sense that also the liquid gas, for what we saw, for what we said last time, behaves in a similar way. Okay, so one can compute from here all the behavior of m close to the critical point, the derivatives, so the susceptibility, the heat capacity, and so on and so forth. Okay, I will not repeat the calculation because they are just the same. Now, what is more important for today actually is to introduce another quantity, which is this correlation function that basically contains, if you want, the one of the main aspects of critical phenomena, which is the divergence of the correlation length. Now, one thing that one should remember from this is that a mean-field approximation corresponds to a minimization of the Helmholtz free energy with respect to the field. Okay. Let me write it here. Mean-field, and this is also for the Ising model approximation. I minimize A with respect to M, and of course neglect fluctuations. Okay, so now let me go on. Let me introduce two more quantities. So let me start with the partition function again, which was this object. Let me write in this way, P0 of P, and I write explicitly the dependence on the external field that now we take as depending on space. Okay. And E0 is the energy functional with H equal to 0. The same function as before, I'm just separating the part that contains H and the part that does not contain H. Now, let me just make a short. So now we are going to compute functional derivatives. So let me just remark how you do a functional derivative that is written in this way. So if you do a functional derivative of H, which is a function of y, for instance, with respect to h of x, x, that is equal to delta in the dimension of y minus x. Okay, this is the rule that we need to use and to remember of this functional derivation. So now if I have the functional derivative with respect to h of x of the functional now, dx of h of, sorry, this y, and py. Now, since the derivative of h of epsilon of 1 with respect to h of x is a delta, then you get a p of x. Okay. The way it works is functional derivative. Okay, so once I have introduced that, I will do the following thing. Questo non mi serve. Direi che mi serve questo qua. If I do the following thing, so if I do 1 divided by beta, functional derivative with respect to h of y of the log of z of c, and you do it, you compute this quantity at h equals 0, what you get is the following. You get 1 divided by z of c, then there is the function integral over the phi of y, for the reason that is written here. When I do the functional derivative of the exponential of e to beta integral of h phi, I get down phi of y. Then I have e to the minus beta e 0 of p, and I still have the well, actually I have 0 here, 1 here, because I put h equal to 0. Okay, vediamo se ho scritto tutto, scusate, eh? 1 più beta c, quella lì, e va bene. And you see that this is actually okay. If I put h equal to 0, this is just the expectation value of p of x. P of y, sorry. Okay, so it's the average ensemble average of p of y. which is a little bit more complicated than before, because this is not the total order parameter, but it's the order parameter in a certain position. Okay? So this ensemble, this ensemble average for the field in a specific point in space, and it is obtained by just doing this functional derivative. Okay? Now this formula is a little bit more abstract with respect to the one that we used before, because we are working with fields, but basically it's just the same as before, in the sense that to find an average value, an expectation value, you take the log of the canonical partition function and you derive with respect to the field, okay, to the external field. So to get, for instance, magnetization, you derive the log of Z of C, which is the Helmholtz free energy, you derive it with respect to the magnetic field. Okay, so it's just the same, just the difference, just that here we have functional derivative, okay, which is a more complicated structure, of course. Now, if you do 1 of beta squared, and you do now twice the functional derivative with respect to H computed in Y and H computed in Z, and you compute it for H equal to 0 of the log of Z of C. Now, in a similar way, as in this case, you get basically the fluctuation of you can call it fluctuation, but actually it's better to call it correlation function, which is the product, the expectation value of the product of phi computed in Y times phi computed in Z minus the product of the single expectation value phi computed in Z. Remember, the fluctuations in energy in the canonical ensemble were indeed computed as a second derivative with respect to beta of the log of Z of C. Okay, so the same structure. When I compute the second derivative of the log, I get basically the fluctuation. Okay, so here is a fluctuation, and here it is called correlation function. What is the meaning of this correlation function? Correlation function. The meaning is the ensemble average of the product of the two fields UY and Z minus the product of the ensemble average of the single field. Okay? So somehow this quantity characterizes the correlation between the values of the field into different points of space. Okay? For completely uncorrelated systems, this will be zero, in the sense that this quantity here would just be the product of the two ensemble average, okay? If there is no correlation. If there is correlation, then there is a difference between this guy here and the product of the two, okay? And the way it's obtained is just the same as the fluctuations, for instance, in the internal energy, or in the energy, better to say, internal energy, yeah. The fluctuation in the number of particles in the grand canonical ensemble. So you take the logarithm of the partition function, the canonical partition function, or the grand canonical partition function, and then you do a second derivative of this logarithm, this fluctuation. Okay. So now let me call it in some way. So let me call it G of Y Z. This is the correlation function. And this is defined to be the
in this way. Now, this way to gravitate is very convenient in the sense that it provides already a clear interpretation of what is a correlation function. But actually, for the calculation that we are going to do today, I hope I'm finished, we will use another way to do this calculation, which is the following. So one can show, and I will provide some motivation for that, that this G of YZ is actually 1 divided by beta, and then I have to do the functional derivative of the expectation value of phi of y computed for a field different from zero with respect to h of z. Okay, so let me just define this relation that I wrote that sometimes is also interpreted as a fluctuation dissipation theory formula. Now, what is this quantity here? This quantity, phi of y, with a finite value of h, this was the integral of d phi. Vediamo che non faccio. Then, okay, there is a 1 divided by z of c, the denominator. And there is d phi. And then there is phi of y, exponential of minus e0 of phi, and then there is e beta integral of h of x and phi of x. Okay. In the expectation value, I put just phi, and it's computed for a final value of the phi, which is h. Here, and divided by the partition function. Now, if I do a functional derivative of this quantity, so you do the functional derivative with respect to h of z, for instance, then you get down also another phi, which will be computed in z. Okay, so you will get here another factor of phi, so you will get phi of y times phi of z. And then you will get another quantity from the denominator, which is z of c, okay? That actually will provide the second term, okay? So once you do the derivative of the numerator, you get down another factor, which will be phi of z, and this will be the expectation value of phi of z. And you when deriving instead of the denominator, you will get another structure like this, but just computed phi of z. Okay, is that the result? Okay, so this is a way to compute. This is the way we will compute actually this correlation function in a moment. So you take just the expectation value of the field with a finite value h, and then you do a functional derivative of this quantity with respect to h. Okay,
so now it's time to do calculations.
And so what we will try to do now is to compute this correlation function. And what we will show is that the correlation function and actually, the correlation length diverges at specifically at the critical point. Okay. So to do that, I need to somehow. Somehow to look back at the functional we started with. This was an integral of dx of epsilon squared divided by 2, and here I have a gradient grounded on phi, then I have a square modulus plus h t squared plus be p to the power of 4, then I have a minus p a. Let me put explicitly the dependence on x, just to remember that now we have an x dependence here. Okay, now let's consider the first guy here, and I have here a gradient squared, which is the gradient scalar, the gradient. And this can be written as the divergence of phi gradient of phi minus phi nabla of phi. Okay, so now when I do this integral here, when integrating over the first term, epsilon squared, I actually have to integrate this term here, which is a divergence, minus this quantity here, right? Now this is going to zero. Because this for the divergence theorem, this will be a surface integral, no? Surface integral, the standard trick. Surface integral and phi is zero for modulus of x going to infinity, or to this large volume here. So therefore, actually, I can reshuffle the square modulus of the gradient as a minus epsilon squared divided by 2 phi times the nabla squared of phi. So once I do that, the functional gets this the following form. So actually, let me use the advantage of having a blackboard, and I start from the same formula, but we just change the first term. That will be a minus epsilon squared divided by 2, and then I have a phi nabla phi. Okay. Plus all the other terms. Okay. Okay, so now let me do this step here. Okay, so let me say something. Consider that this part of the course maybe will deserve another course, in the sense that this is really what is called statistical field theory. Okay, so maybe something will be not as an experiment. So maybe I'm going a little bit too fast, but yeah, in any case, let me continue. And at the end, you can ask me questions if you want. Now, in the canonical partition function, we had this form here, and we know also that A is minus KBT log of Z of C. Mean field, as I said before, means in our case neglect fluctuations. Which means fluctuations in the ensemble. And here we are doing this little bit different with respect to what we did before, and minimize A with respect to with respect to the order parameter, okay? Back to the order parameter. Now, in order to minimize with respect to the order parameter, basically it consists in minimizing this quantity here, okay? So the functional. So this means I have to minimize E of phi, which is a functional, with respect to by the way, minimizing this quantity with respect to phi is called the saddle point approximation that we haven't done, but basically which is the motivation, so the meaning of that. In this integral, of course, you will have many contributions to this fat integral, basically. The most important one will be the one with the minimum energy, okay? Because the larger the energy, the more suppressed is the contribution of that specific configuration of the field to the fat integral. So the most important contribution actually will come from the field configuration that minimizes this quantity, okay? And actually, the mean field approximation in a mathematical point, from a mathematical point of view, is actually considered to be a saddle point approximation. Okay, so let's stick to this. Let's minimize now this quantity, okay? With respect to p of x, which means that I have to compute a functional derivative of e and then put this functional derivative to zero. So let's compute the functional derivative of e with respect to phi of y and let's see what I get. I need to do the functional derivative of this quantity. So here I have a minus epsilon squared times the lambda of phi of y plus 2at phi of y. Okay, then we have 4b phi of y cubed minus h of y, and this is equal to 0. Okay, some comments. Okay, so here it is simple. You get a factor of 2 here, at and phi of y, because remember that if I do the derivative, the functional derivative of phi of y with respect to phi of z, I get the delta d of y minus z. Okay. So this is simple. This is also fine. I get 4b e to the power of 3, I compute the derivative of this and I get the factor of h of y. The only thing that takes a little bit of time, but one has to remember something, is the fact that here I had a factor of 1/2 that I have not anymore here. The reason is the following, that when you do the functional derivative of with respect to phi of y, we said, of p nabla of p, which is a function of x here. Now this is equal to the nabla squared of p of y, because you derive first this guy here, plus, then you have a phi of, let me see, phi of y, phi of x is not important at this level. And then I have another squared of the delta d of y minus x. Okay? So the functional derivative x first on this guy here and provides this term, then you have to derive with the respect to the field that was inside the Navier squared and then get a delta. Now, if I do the second derivative of a delta in one dimension, for instance, is actually like computing so let us remember this point of the mathematical methods of physics. If you do the second derivative of a delta, is actually the second derivative of the test function. Okay. So actually, this term here corresponds again to the Laplacian, so to the Laplace squared of the, for this reason, basically. Because if you do the second derivative of a delta, or a Laplace squared of a delta, is actually the second derivative of the test function. Okay. So at the end, you get a factor of 2 here. Okay? So this is twice Laplace squared of t of y. So that's why you don't have this factor of 2. Bene. Okay, so we got this equation now that I will write in a moment. So the equation that we need to solve is the following. So 0 is equal to minus epsilon squared lambda squared of p of y plus 2a p of y plus 4b p cubed minus epsilon h of y, sorry, equal to 0. Okay, good. Now the solution of this differential equation is P of y H limited approximation. Why limited approximation? Because we have basically considered in the functional, we have just minimizing the functional integral with respect to the field. We are not considering fluctuations of due to the ensemble, but we will actually consider the possibility that P is not uniform because of the presence of a magnetic, of an external field. Okay. So what we are doing now with respect to the previous case, we just consider everything to be uniform. So we have a constant field, external field, and then the other parameter is uniform. Now all we do is to work in limited approximation. That means that we are neglecting the fluctuations due to the ensemble, the statistical fluctuations, but we have a configuration of the other parameter which is not necessarily uniform because we have an external field that depends actually on the position. Okay, and now by using the formula that we said before, so we said before that the correlation function g of yz is equal to 1 divided by beta, the functional derivative with respect to h of z of the expectation value of p of y, and the finite value of h. Now, what we do is to use this formula in here. So, since this equation is providing the solution at mean field of p of y, then we take this exploring asterisks, and do the functional derivative as in this case with respect to h of x or h of z. Okay. Okay. When I do that, I get zero that is equal to minus epsilon squared. And here I will have another squared of g epsilon cosa ho messo qua? X, okay. Because I'm deriving with respect to h of x. Then I have a beta, which is not important, but okay, let me keep it for the moment. 2at, which is this term here. Then I have, yeah, so it's the same as before. So g of epsilon x times beta. Che è questo qua, 2 a g per la g, ok, più plus 4 b beta g of epsilon yx is to the power of 3, yes, yeah, and this actually I also have a power of 2 here. Giusta questa cosa, so let me just think for a moment the beta, because now I'm getting confused with the beta. I think it is a beta, yeah. Okay, I will think in a moment this, but it's not important because at the end we are going to reshuffle the expression. Then I have a plus. Now, yeah, here comes the point, which is a minus, actually, minus delta d of y minus x. That is equal to zero. Now let me do the following. First of all, let me call beta g just to make it simple. Well, beta of g, which is a function of epsilon and y, let me call it for x equal to zero. And it would be equal to phi of y, for a reason that will be clear in a moment. Two, let me neglect the cubic term. Why? Because I want to do calculations. By using the Fourier transform. Okay. And the fact that I'm putting x equal zero is the following. Here I have a function that depends on y and x. But actually, if the system has no, let's say, particular if the system is has not something specific occurring in a certain location, so for translation invariance, the correlation between y and x will be also the correlation between y and x equals zero. In the sense, it's not important the absolute position, but just the relative position. So, and then I can put, I can reshift everything and scale to refer to x equal to zero. Okay, just for translation of the buttons. Okay, so please. So, since the delta depends on this quantum, the difference, also this function here, which is a green function basically, depends just on the difference, and let me put the zero in x equal to zero, just for that. Okay, so in this way, the formula that we had is actually a more reasonable shape, which is the following. For stuff, we have an under squared of this capital phi plus 2at phi. Now I'm neglecting the cubic term, and this is just a delta of y. Quindi meno opzione, sì, 2t. Ok. Good. So now, this is an equation that you know, and actually you see that this equation provides the green function for a standard problem, because you have a source which is a delta, and basically the equation that we have here is the equation for the green function of this equation, differential equation, no? So the solution would be the green function. Now, this equation can be integrated easily by using the Fourier transform. That's why I neglected the cubic term, because otherwise it's not linear. And using the Fourier transform. So, in principle, I just will introduce the field, which is P of X, will be in general dvk divided by 2i to the power of d, e to the ikx, where this is a scalar product in d dimension. Then I have the tilde, the t tilde of k. Now, you take this, you put it here, and as usual, you get from a differential equation an algebraic equation, which is the following, no? So you get that the phi, capital P tilde k, is 1, comes from the delta, divided by epsilon squared k squared, with a minus here, becomes a plus epsilon squared k squared, plus 2at. Now, the calculation proceeds as usual, in the sense now you have to do an inverse Fourier transform of this quantity here. But let's notice one thing. I will not do the calculation the full calculation, because the structure is clear. So we have now that phi of x, apart from some constant, will be an inverse Fourier transform of this quantity. Okay, so it will be something like the integral from dk of e to the minus I k x divided by epsilon squared k squared plus 2at. Now, you can do the integral easily in three dimensions, for instance. In three dimensions, I know how to do it exactly. In d dimension, it's more complicated. But the thing is the following, that you get a contribution here from a pole, which is in 2at divided by epsilon squared, that will appear in exponential. And you will have another factor of 1 divided by x. So let me do it in the case of 3 dimensions, just to convince you that this, that this is actually the case. So in 3 dimensions, you will get actually 1 divided by 2 pi cubed integral of d3k. Aspettate, qui c'è un meno, c'è un più, vediamo un attimino. Questo l'ho definito col più in realtà, questo è un più, questo è un plus. Dikx, which will be three dimensional, would be just a standard product as usual. Then here we have epsilon squared k squared plus 2ak, and this is the phi of x. Now, so what you do here typically is the following: phi of x is equal to 1 divided by 2 pi squared. Then we have integral dk k squared from 0 plus infinity, integral d cos theta minus 1 to 1 of e to the I k x cos theta divided by epsilon squared k squared plus 2at. C'ho tutto? Sì. Now, when you do the integral with respect to d cos theta, you get a factor of 1 divided by x as the denominator, okay? So I can write really the structure with respect to a prefactor that will be something like this, okay? Models of x. That comes from the first integral. Then you have, once you do that, you have the typical structure that you do with the residual theorem. So you will have just an exponential here, which must be computed at the zero of this guy here. So if you put epsilon squared k squared plus 2at zero, you get that k is equal to plus minus I 2at divided by epsilon squared square root. Okay, and therefore, so you will have here an exponential in the important part of minus modulus of x divided by a quantity. You scrive on modo terribile, and this should be xi, this correlation length. That is provided by 2it epsilon squared to the minus 1 half. Okay? 2it diviso epsilon squared minus 1 half. So, what is the message? The message is that the quantity that we are computing, it is called a correlation function. This one, this right here, correlation function in the mean field approximation. Has the following structure. Maybe from all these calculations, this is the most important part that you have to remember. I will not ask you this calculation because I was too fast probably, and we need more time. But the most important part that one has to remember is the following. First of all, one, when t approaches zero, you see that there is a divergence of the correlation length. So that means that the points in two different, so that means that this exponential suppression does not exist anymore, okay? So when the correlation length is finite, you have an exponential suppression of the correlation of two points, which is something that you usually expect, okay? point which are far away will be will have a correlation which is exponentially suppressed. Whereas when you are at t equals zero, which means close to the critical point, the correlation length diverges, okay, and the correlation function has a power law shape, so a long range is like a long range correlation or long range force. Which is not is no more exponentially suppressed, but it's a power law. Okay. So the basically the physics that is occurring at the critical point is mainly dominated by the fact that the correlation length diverges. The correlation function is a power law. That means that the system itself cannot be somehow reduced, if you want, to the interaction of, if you think about the spins, to a single spin with the closest neighbors. But it's a long-range correlation, so it's a long-range interaction. And basically, all the spins interact with all the other spins, being suppressed by a power law, which is much less suppressed than an exponential, of course. Okay? And this is the reason for which, at the critical point, you see all these macroscopic effects. So the fact that the system behaves some way that is called a collective, is a collective phenomenon, it's called. That you see, for instance, magnetization. Magnetization means basically that the correlation is so large that once you somehow flip a spin, and this information is basically provided to all the material on a macroscopic scale, and that's why then the magnetization would be finite. Okay, so you have these long range correlations. And similarly, what happens in the liquid gas phase transition, we are close to the critical point. What diverges here, so the correlation length, of course. And what's happening then is that you have large fluctuations in density, in which you cannot even distinguish what is the liquid, what is the gas. Okay? Then, if you go below the critical temperature, there is a phase separation, but the critical phenomenon is occurring at the critical point where these two phases are not distinguishable anymore, okay? Because of this. Larger fluctuation, in particular in the density in this case. Okay, so just to make it per cultura personale, now here one can introduce two more critical exponents which are related to the correlation function. Two more critical exponents. We have seen four of them, alpha, beta, delta, and gamma, which were related to the specific heat, the equation of state, the order parameter, and to the susceptibility. Then there are other two more critical exponents. One of them is this, so this xi, which is the correlation length scale, as t to the minus mu, and we just derived that mu is equal to 1/2 and midfield in the midfield approximation. Okay, this is one point. So this is a new critical exponent. There is another critical exponent that is introduced that we cannot justify being at this level, but is the following. If you do calculations at as with d dimensions, and by considering the only field corrections. One can prove that this correlation function P of X, where we are now in D dimension, has a following shape. It has the exponential of minus x divided by the correlation left as before, and then there is x modulus of x to the power of 2 minus e minus eta. We have done just the case in which d is equal to 3, therefore we have 2 minus 3, which is minus 1, and we have a power law 1 over modulus of x. But actually, in the dimension, you get this 2 minus d, and then you have another correction, which is eta, which is another critical exponent. And this is called the anomalous dimension. Anomalous dimension. Which, if you want, effectively corrects the number of dimensions of your system. But this is something that appears when you go beyond the video to renormalization. Maybe some of you have seen this in quantum field theory, maybe, when doing renormalization. Qualcuno forse la sa, sta cosa. Possibile? Maybe apply quantum field theory?
No.
No? Okay. Anyway, this is something that we really do not have the time to do because it would be another chapter, another course. But basically, it's due to the this is the beginning of renormalization, if you want, in statistical theory. Okay. And but so what is important to me is just to, for you, per cultura generale, that you it's important that you know that there is a new critical exponent which is related to the correlation length, which we can compute, and we have computed in midfield actually, is 1/2. And there is another one which is this critical exponent related to the anomalous dimension. But that's something that appears when you go beyond the field. Okay. So now just to conclude this part. Actually, in midfield approximation, eta is equal to zero. So let me just make a summary. Midfield critical exponents. So alpha, beta, gamma, delta, mu, and eta. This is 0, this is 1/2, delta is 3, gamma is 1, beta is 1/2, and alpha is 0. So, when thinking about possible topics that you, if you want, of course, you can try to work out by yourself. Poi vi spiego come potrebbe funzionare. Maybe one possibility is to try to compute the same critical exponents, but for this one, these two, but the first four, in the case of a liquid gas phase transition, and to see that if you take the van der Waals, you get actually this three. I think I have commented just on this, but in principle, one can compute also the other three critical exponents and find that this. Of course, this is interesting because it's the fact that you have so many different, let's say, phase transition with the same critical exponent is a sign of what is called universality. Okay, so you have different microscopic interactions, different systems that behave close to the critical point in a similar fashion. Okay, so now. In principle, there is another thing that another topic that is related to critical exponent, which is scaling. I will just introduce it, and then if we can manage, we manage, otherwise we stop it, okay? Because next time I want to talk about a little bit about the Brownian motion
and the random walk, and in a simple way, I will introduce the Einstein relation. We will not do Langevin equation, there's no time. Of course, there are just 2 hours left. Okay, so the next topic, which is still related to critical phenomena, is a chapter that is called scaling, and basically comes from what we have done before. What we found before, okay, so let me maybe comment on a point. So when we wrote the functional of the order parameter, okay, there was this lambda phi, so the gradient of phi squared plus then we had scrivo direttamente la versione derivata forse. So the equation that we had was at zero, sorry, that minus epsilon squared lambda squared of p plus 2 a t of p is equal to a delta v of y, and okay, this is a function of y, and this is a function of y. Okay, so now for those of you who are familiar, maybe you are familiar, or all of you are familiar, this is a sort of flying Gordon equation, no? Because it's an equation, differential equation for a scalar field that basically it's like that you have instead of a mass squared, you have the role played by the mass squared, if you want, displayed at this quantity here. 2AT will be volt P, a mass to the power of 2 in a Klein-Gordon equation. So actually, what I'm saying about the critical point, the correlation length, is something that you already know in a different fashion. In the sense that if you take a Klein-Gordon equation and you are, for instance, describing a pion or a scalar, a pseudo-scalar or a scalar field, you know that when you solve the Klein-Gordon equation with a finite value of the mass, you get the Yukawa potential, no? So if you think about this, Klein-Gordon for a massive particle, you get the Yukawa potential. And the Yukawa potential has a subtraction like this one, right? As an exponential of minus r times n, the mass of the particle, divided by r. These are Yukawa potential. And here we are basically recovering the same structure because the equation is the same, okay? So now, in the case of Yukawa, you know that the larger the mass, the more that the potential is suppressed. And here is the same. If we are above TC, this term is positive. So it works, if you want, like a mass in the Yukawa potential, and you have an exponential suppression of the optical ratio. Whereas if you have m equal to zero, you have a Coulomb potential here. And this is a typical long-range force.
And here you have a divergence of the correlation length, and you have a structure of the correlation function, which is full of life. So what I found here is basically just the same feature that you see in particle physics when working with the massive scalar particles. Okay, so you get a structure of the potential, which is like a Yukawa potential. Okay. So the fact when you see these two at, you immediately see that the fact that t, when t is equal to zero, you have a divergence of the correlation length, which corresponds to a massless particle that propagates, of course, and it is a long range force. And similarly here, you have a long range correlations because this mass term, if you want, is equal to zero. Okay, so this was just a comment. This will provide you another way to understand this, this equation. Okay, now the scaling part, it's rather long actually, so I will not do the full calculation. I will stop at some point when we finish our time, then this time we involve, otherwise we stop it here. Okay, but what is the argument? The argument is that when you are close to the critical point, you just seen before that you have the correlation length diverges. So that means that two speeds are correlated not only if they are very close by, but also if they are at, say, macroscopic distances. Okay. And the fact that you don't have a typical, you don't have somehow typical length scale that characterizes your system at the critical point. And that makes you think about what is called scale invariance, in the sense that your system somehow is the same if you look at it with a microscope with different lenses. If you take a more powerful lens, you get a certain picture of your system, but if you decrease the power of this lens, you actually see the same structure because there is not typical landscape. Okay, so what is occurring at the critical point is basically the fact that you don't have a landscape that characterizes your system, and then if you see the system with different resolutions, you actually would see the same. Okay, there's a nice picture in the book of Wang that you can have a look to. So somehow one can try to exploit the fact that we have scale invariance at the critical point and find with very few assumptions, actually one assumption, a relation between the critical exponents that actually say that we have six critical exponents, but actually only two of them are independent. They are actually, all of these six critical exponents can be described by just two parameters that characterize, for instance, the Gibbs potential in the way we are going to do it at the critical point. Okay, so this is more or less the idea. So you don't have, so you have scale invariance. And when you have scale invariance, you can make some reasonable hypothesis on the behavior of the Gibbs potential that I will explain in a moment. And this will provide you relations between critical exponents that have been actually confirmed by the experiments. Okay. So scaling. First of all, one needs to introduce what is called a homogeneous function. In one dimension, let's start with one dimension. A homogeneous function in one dimension has the following property. Suppose that you have f of lambda is it. So this is the definition of homogeneous function. Suppose that you have a parameter which is lambda, and then an exponent which is L, and you do a scaling, so you rescale the x, the independent variable in this parameter. The result of the scaling of the independent variable, which would just be a scaling of the old function, but the function would be the same. Okay? It's basically homogeneous function. And that actually has a very simple interpretation, because if you, for instance, put lambda Lx to choose it to be 1, because lambda and L are, you are free to choose the value of lambda and L. From this you see that lambda L is x to the minus 1, therefore lambda is equal to x to the minus 1 divided by L. And therefore, from this relation, f of 1 is equal to lambda, so this lambda is x to the minus 1 divided by L times f of x, from which I get that f of x is equal to x1 divided by L f of 1. What is that? It's a power loss. So in one dimension, a homogeneous function is just a power law. So it's a constant number, f of 1, times x to the power of something, 1 divided by f. Okay, this is arbitrary, completely arbitrary. The thing is that it is a power law, in the sense that it's x to some exponent that could be whatever number, also a real number. Okay. Now, this is in one dimension. So what is interesting out of that? It's interesting the fact that you do a rescaling of the independent variable and you get the same function as before, but for a correction. Okay? But the function itself remains the same. Okay? And this is somehow the property that one wants to exploit at the critical point. Because at the critical point, since we have this correlation length diverges, that means that we do not have a typical scale. And that's why we can infer that what is the structure of the thermodynamics there, okay, in particular the G-spring energy. Now, in more than one dimension, actually two dimensions, one introduced the generalized homogeneous functions. Which are defined in a similar way as before. Now we have f of lambda px lambda qy is equal to lambda f of x is y. And this is called a homogeneous function of a function of two variables of order p in x and q in y. Okay, this is just a definition. Okay. Now we can do a little trick also here to show that a function like that, so having this property, actually depends not independently on x and y, but just on a specific combination of x and y. And the trick is that, as before, is to impose that, for instance, lambda q y is equal to 1. So I can choose lambda and q now that this would be 1. And from this I can get that the lambda is y to the minus 1 divided by q. Y to the minus 1 divided by q. Yeah, that's correct. And then I can put this in here. And at the end, derive the f of xy, this right here, is 1 over lambda times this f, which at the end becomes epsilon of 1 divided by q, which comes from the heat. And then here I have f of lambda q y is equal to 1. And instead of lambda p x, I have x y to the power of minus p divided by q. So that means that a homogeneous generalized function, which depends on two independent variables, actually can be reshuffled in a way that it is actually a function of only a specific combination of x and y. Okay, if the order is p in x and q in y, actually can be somehow managed to be written as a function of just a combination of x and y. Like that. So it depends just on the ratio between x and y to the power of p divided by 2. Okay. Now, just to make an example of homogeneous function, suppose that you have f of x and y is equal to x epsilon x squared. Now we do the scaling and we import the descaling is equal to lambda f of x and y. So what you do is basically you substitute here lambda p x and lambda q y and you import it, you get the same results. So we get x, y, and here we have a lambda pq plus lambda 2p x squared imposed is equal to lambda xy plus lambda x squared, and then at the end you get that p is equal to q is equal to 1. So typically functions like those, like this one, are homogeneous functions. But in general, you can see that this homogeneous function generalized typically are of this sort. So they can be written as x to the power of alpha, x to the power of beta plus blah blah blah, x to the power of gamma, x to the power of delta, etc. Okay. So they have a structure like this, but they are, if you want to generalize the power law, if you want, or power law two dimensions, or combination of power laws. Of course, for sure, if you have exponential functional forms, they will not be homogeneous functions. Okay? They are not homogeneous. So if you think about the correlation function that we derived before, there is an exponential there. This is not homogeneous, but what is homogeneous is exactly that correlation function at the critical point, because in that case we have a power law. Okay. Now these are just a mathematical introduction that we will need at some point. Now I just want to introduce which is the technique, and then I will stop when time is over. And so basically the idea of several guys, Kadanoff, William, etc., is the following. Suppose that we have two-dimensional, let's take a two-dimensional island model. So in this model we have a lattice of spins . Suppose that we have L, which is the length of the lattice, and suppose that N is the number of spin. And we have an energy, which was the energy of the one dimension of the sorry, this is the two-dimensionalized model, which was minus epsilon, the sum of the closest spin, S, I, S, J, minus the sum from K1 to N of Sk times field, which is H. Okay? Now, what you do is to, as I said before, at the critical point, we have long-range correlations. Therefore, we can start to think about the system not in terms of single spin, but in terms of blocks. So you describe the system by changing degrees of freedom and by not considering spins anymore, but blocks of spins with a length L such that L times L, capital L times L is smaller or equal to the correlation length. So basically what I'm doing here is the number of correlated spins, if you want. Okay, so, and the number of correlated spins times the length, the step of the lattice, must be smaller than the correlation length. So in this way, you are somehow saying, or you are treating, you are considering the fact that the correlation between spins close to the critical point is not really, let's say, closest interaction, closest neighbor interaction, but it's an interaction that somehow involves more spin. How many? Well, basically this is provided by the correlation length. That's why instead of treating the degrees of freedom as a single spin, you get degrees of freedom now which are blocks of spins. So suppose that L is equal to 3, for instance. So you will describe the system now in a different way. So you take an L, L equal 3 times 3 block, for instance. And we substitute the spins with just blocks, and we assign to a single block a new spin, which will be S prime of I. You have to select a certain rule to define the spin. For instance, you count. You take S prime to have the value of the majority of spins inside the block. But this is a possible rule. So if, let's say, 60% of the spins in this block are up, you take the spin of the block to be up, okay? Which is just a possible thing. So now the picture is that you will change from this picture with spin, with degrees of freedom made of single spins, with an energy, which is the one that I just deleted, and now I will write it again, is minus epsilon sum of ij, S I S J minus H sum of K 1 to N of S K. Now this is with spin with the step L and M spins, and you go for a new picture with the same energy, because the energy of the system does not depend on the fact that you are rearranging your degrees of freedom. It must be the same, but you are changing the variables, and therefore you will also change the couplings. So you will have epsilon prime, the sum over ij of s prime j s prime I, that are the degrees of freedom, now the spins of the blocks, okay, which are S prime, minus also this P we change in general in order to be, in order to preserve the value of the energy, and so also the field will be different in general, and this is a sum K1, S prime of K, and now before this we have N. Now, how many degrees of freedom we have in this case? We have less degrees of freedom, and in particular, we have n divided by n to the power of b. Okay, indeed, so this is indeed a dimension. So why such? Because every spin, so this is the two-dimensional case that I can draw on the blackboard. If you are in D dimension, the number of degrees of freedom will be reduced by a factor L to the power of D. So if you are in two dimension, will be reduced by a factor of L squared. Okay, but in D dimension, the number of blocks will be N divided by L to the power of D. Okay. Now you notice here that we actually, by this transformation, we have a transformation of scale of length scale, if you want. Because now the size of the spins is not as before, but is L, capital L time L, a single block has this size, okay? So it's a scale, it's a variation of the length scale, and we say that H is actually transformed into H prime. And also epsilon has been changed to epsilon prime. Now remember that epsilon is proportional to TC, because TC was, we have proven that there is a proportionality factor by the critical temperature and the coupling spin. Therefore, if I change epsilon to epsilon prime, that implies also that I change T to T prime, because T is the temperature minus TC divided by TC. So if I change epsilon to epsilon prime, I will also change TC, and therefore I will change T. That's why the scaling that I'm doing, so you're rearranging the spins in a different way, produces as a side effect a change of the couplings, and therefore also on the variable T, and the change of the external field H prime. Okay. Now here we are going to use in a moment the properties of homogeneous function. But let me first do some thermodynamics. The first principle of thermodynamics, dQ, in presence of magnetization, is the following. So this is in presence of magnetization. So why is that? So dQ is equal to variation of the thermal energy minus HBM. Why this is reasonable? If I fix this number and I provide heat to the system, well, what I do expect is to decrease the total magnetization. So if I put heat to the system, then it will be negative, okay? So I will reduce the magnetization and H positive, okay? So this is reasonable. And similarly for the other case, okay? So if I extract heat at a fixed energy, I will increase the magnetization in order to get heat extracted, which is negative. Now, okay, one can also derive from these one can derive. What is the expression for the Helmholtz free energy and for the Gibbs free energy? And let me be a little bit faster otherwise. So for the Gibbs free energy in particular, one can show for the Gibbs free energy that you get minus SVT minus MVH, and therefore the derivative of the Gibbs free energy with respect to H equal to minus n. And G is the Gibbs free energy. Okay. So now what I do is to work with the free energy, which is a function, as you see, G is a function of T and H. In the case of a gas system, G would be a function of T and pressure, whereas in this case of a magnetic system, it's a function of T and external field H. The role played by the pressure is played by the magnetic field, and a few things we said also before. So we work with this because we are in our system and we are working with the variables T, small t, and H that we have been rescaled to T prime and H prime. Therefore, the proper thermodynamical potential to work with it is the G potential. Okay, so now let me introduce small g, which is capital G divided by the number of degrees of freedom. Which will be total number of spin before the scaling and total number of blocks after the scaling. Now the main hypothesis is in this game is that the Gibbs potential at the critical point is a generalized homogeneous function. And this is called Wigon hypothesis. Or Wigon scaling. Better to say, Wigon scaling. Okay, the Wigon scaling hypothesis says that G close to C is a generalized homogeneous function. Okay, so that means that basically, if I do g t prime h prime, well, this t prime and h prime are due to the fact that I was reshuffling my degrees of freedom. Instead of taking a lattice step of small l, I'm taking a lattice step of l times capital L. So it's a scaling in length that I'm doing now. Now, this is equal by hypothesis to L to the power of D times G T H. Okay. Where T prime is equal to one introduce two exponents L to the power of P and H prime, which is equal to L to the power. Okay, so this is the starting point basically of this game. Now, this can be written in a slightly different way just to be more compatible with what we wrote. So, actually, we will not have time, but in principle, this is useful, and also the one I'm about to write in a moment is also useful. But you can introduce a parameter, you can call it lambda, this guy here. And okay, so let me maybe comment on the fact that why you should have this L to the power of D. Because somehow you must compensate the fact that in this case the number of spins is capital N, whereas in this case the number of degrees of freedom, which are the blocks, is actually n divided by L to the power of T. Okay, that's why there is a L to the power of T. Okay, so now this can be written in a slightly different way by just introducing a lambda and two more coefficients, two more exponents that will be different with respect to those ones, but can be rewritten as g t lambda p. Well, in principle, this is a p prime, but let me stick to p, right? That will be different in the case with respect to the previous one, but let's not complicate too much the story. Then I have a h lambda to the power of q, which is equal to lambda g t h. Now, I think you can say that p and q different from the previous one. And actually, they are proportional in the sense that these are p. With respect to the previous one, there is a factor of p. Okay. If I have time, I will come back, but actually, we don't have time. Now, this is the starting point. Okay. Now, what you can do, what we can do, and I will finish with that, is just to see that now the magnetization, the total magnetization was minus the derivative of the Higgs free energy with respect to H at fixed temperature, and the magnetization per degrees of freedom is minus the derivative of G with respect to H at fixed temperature. So therefore, I can take this formula and use it in here to derive now the critical exponents close to the critical point. Okay? So if I use this from this relation, I derive with respect to with respect to H, I will get that lambda cube magnetization computed in lambda pt, and here I have H lambda cube, is equal to lambda m t h. Okay, so I'm deriving with respect to the second argument, therefore the magnetic field, therefore I will have a lambda q to multiply this m. Okay, now from this one I can already compute the first critical exponent. I just put h equal to zero. And let me put lambda pt equal to 1, anzi to minus 1, but okay, this is completely arbitrary, honestly, so okay, this is a possible choice. So if you do that, so you take h equal to 0 in both terms, you put lambda pt equal to minus 1, this is just an example, and then you will get that m of t 0 is equal to m of minus 1 0, which is a number, times minus t to the power of 1 minus q divided by t. Okay, you just get from this relation, you get that the lambda is minus t to the minus 1 divided by p, and you take this lambda and you put it in here, and then you invert it, take this bridge. Okay. Now the critical exponent can be derived by taking the behavior of the magnetization close to t equals zero, that is a power law that you see already, and by remembering which was the definition of the critical exponent theta, you see that theta, which was the critical exponent associated with the order parameter, beta is 1 minus q divided by p. Okay, so one can write this critical exponent in terms of q and p, which are these two scaling parameters that we introduced in the middle of my hypothesis. Now you can do easily the game and get another critical exponent, which starts again from this, so lambda q and lambda p t lambda q h is equal to lambda m of t h, which is the starting point, lambda t h and lambda p lambda q h on that. Now you put in here p equal to zero, so you sit exactly at the critical point, and take lambda qh equal to 1, as before, we did here, for t, but in this case we do it for the magnetic field, for the external field. Now, if you do that, you will see that m of 0h is equal to m of 0,1. You invert again as before, times h, 1 minus q divided by q, from which you derive a second critical exponent, that is delta, which is q divided by 1 minus q. Okay? So we have already two critical exponents in terms of just two scaling parameters. Now we can go on and, for instance, derive the susceptibility was the derivative of the magnetization with respect to H, the isothermal susceptibility, to be more precise. It was the derivative of M with respect to H at fixed temperature. Now you do the same trick as before, so you start from this. Now this time you derive this quantity with respect to H again, and you will get a factor of lambda to the power of 2 q, different from the case of before. No? So from here you will see that lambda to the power of twice q, the isothermal susceptibility computed in lambda pt lambda qh is equal to lambda isothermal pt susceptibility computed in th. And as before, what you do now, we put h equals 0. And lambda p t equal to 1, and then at the end you get the isothermal susceptibility as a function of t at zero magnetic field, which is the way we define it, is proportional, so it is a number, times t to 1 minus 2 q divided by p. Therefore, we get another critical exponent, which was the gamma, which is equal to 2q minus 1 divided by p. Now, the story goes on. Of course, I will not have time to do it. One can derive also the specific heat. One can derive the correlation length, but it's a little bit more difficult. So then, at the end, we can go on doing that and get all the critical exponents, the six critical exponents, in terms of these just two parameters. Okay? So let me make a summary. So beta 1 minus q divided by p, then delta is q divided by 1 minus q, then gamma is 2 q minus 1 divided by p. One can derive alpha, which is associated with the specific heat, which is 2 minus 1 divided by p. And though it's a little bit more complicated, the one can also compute that theta is equal to 2 plus d minus twice qd,
Of course, you don't have to learn this. Non dovete impararla a memoria, perché chi se ne ricorda. Non sapete solo cosa c'è dietro. E la finale qual era? Era quella del l'ultimo one. So in total we have six critical exponents. In terms of two parameters. That can be also be written in terms of relations between the critical exponents. Okay, so one can write now a relation between the critical exponents, and in particular one can write four relations between critical exponents. But just for completeness, I will write, but as I said before, you don't have to learn it because it's useless, completely useless. But just to one of them is alpha plus 2 beta plus gamma is equal to 2, then gamma is equal to beta delta minus 1. The first one is called the Rushbrook equation. The second one is Wheaton. Of course, there is a story behind that, because before they were just inequalities, then they have been shown to be inequalities later on, and then verified experimentally. And the other two are the Josephson and Fisher. So this is lambda d is equal to 2 minus alpha, which is Josephson. And the last one is Fisher, lambda is equal to 2 minus alpha. You don't have to learn it, as I said before, just to say that the two parameters, P and Q, you get six critical exponents. And therefore, these four relations between them. Why this is interesting? Because actually it reduces even more the degrees of freedom that you have at the critical point, in the sense that the two parameters, there are just two parameters independent, if you want, or two critical exponents that are independent. Okay, you can get the other ones from this relation, and this has been verified experimentally. Va bene, allora direi che chiudiamo questa parte, che è stata abbastanza, forse, troppo. Troppo veloce. Dunque, volevo dirvi questa cosa sull'esame. Appunto, io ho pensato di fare così. Adesso poi è chiaro che la registrazione non c'è bisogno che la vada avanti. Interrompi.